Good morning. Welcome to Queen Anne's County's Board of Education. May I have a motion to go into closed session?
As permitted by the Section 3-305B of the General Provisions, Article of Annotated Code of Maryland, I move that we go into closed session. First, for the appointment, employment, assignment, promotion, discipline, demotion, compensation, removal, resignation, or performance evaluation of appointees, employees, or officials over whom this public body has jurisdiction, or any other personnel matter that affects one or more specific individuals. Two, to discuss administrative functions and to obtain legal advice on the matter.
Okay, may I have a second?
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed say no. We will now move into closed session and we will be returning back at 11:30 a.m.
Welcome back. This is a public meeting that is being videotaped for county citizens to review on QACTV 7, a local cable station. The agenda is available on the information table. During this meeting, we ask that you turn off your cell phones and hold personal conversations and comments outside the meeting room. We will now stand and be led in the Pledge of Allegiance by Board President Arlene Taylor.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Mr. Paluski, you will introduce your first presentation.
Yes, good morning, board members. Presenting this morning is Mr. Rob Watkins, our supervisor of mathematics. And this is a follow-up on our progress report on our academic performance. You remember at the last board meeting, Mrs. Bridget Hoban did an overview of our ELA data for middle school as well as or from the secondary, elementary and secondary. So this is a follow-up in working with Ms. Pauls to prepare, give you a little bit of an overview of kind of where we are and some of the work that Rob and his entire team are doing. So I'll turn it over to Mr. Watkins and followed by Ms. Pauls as well that will intervene as necessary. So Mr. Watkins, welcome.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning. Good morning.
Thanks for having an opportunity here to just kind of tell you what's going on in the math program. We'll share a little data. We'll talk a little graduation requirement stuff, and I'll share with you all the exciting things that we're doing in our math department currently and the coming months and years. So, of course, the purpose of our presentation here is to update, provide updates to the math program and initiatives and the next steps for this coming 17-18 school year. The objective is the same. I thought that it made sense for us to start with some of the requirements because we're in, you know, a year where there's still change happening in our education setup. So I thought we'd start with some requirements. So as you guys know, Park Math is given to all of our students in grades 3 through Algebra 2. We do not give it in Park Geometry. We currently have chosen not to give that assessment because it's not a required assessment for our programs. The students, the current junior class was the initial class that came into the requirement where they have to have 4 math credits. They have to be enrolled in at least 4 credits through the course of their high school careers. The way that language is written is they have to take at least 1 math class each year of their high school career. That language and that rule was in alignment with the University of Maryland system requirement for admissions, and that's all University of Maryland system schools. We currently require 3 credits for our students to graduate, but they still are required to take a 4th course, at least sit for it during their senior year. And, you know, of course, the vast majority of our students pass that 4th year course as well. So we feel like we're preparing our kids very, very well for admittance into a USM school. You guys also,
You can't, if they don't take that 4th class, they're not required.
Well, right? It's a compliance rule. So the law states that we are required to place kids into 4 years of mathematics.
But that requirement for a credit out of that one isn't a requirement.
As far
they
as
only need 3 credits.
That is correct.
But they sit for 4 classes.
Sure.
Gotcha.
Sure. But for all University of Maryland 4-year schools, they're required to have 4 math credits, 1 each year.
When even
each
be considered.
Year.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we felt very strongly that was needed for our students to have that opportunity. So when they go apply to Frostburg or Salisbury or University of Maryland College Park, that or UMBS, they have that in their toolbox and ready to do so.
Gotcha.
Well, why didn't we just make it a graduation requirement then? I mean, you're making it a requirement, but you're not making it a requirement.
Sure. About half the districts in the state of Maryland require 3 math credits to graduate, and the other half are in the 4. At this point, we're currently sticking with 3. We could certainly explore the possibility of adding a 4th requirement to our students.
Can they get into a 2-year school with just the 3 credits? That's the decider.
Likely, yes. Of course, there's a lot more flexibility in community colleges than the 4-year schools. This was a rule that the University of Maryland system put in place in 2009, and they officially adopted it in 2014. So it's something that when the law from Maryland came forward, it made sense for us to, well, we have to comply, but it makes sense to.
It's part of the college completer.
We want our students to have that opportunity.
Similar like having languages, 2 languages in order to graduate, 2 credits.
For the first time this year, Park Algebra 1 counts. So all kids currently sitting in Algebra 1 for the first time will take the Park assessment, and they are required to pass it with a score, level 3 score of 725. So that's something that we are working on. And that's currently our 8th grade Algebra 1 students and most of our 9th grade Algebra 1 students. If they took the Park Algebra 1 in previous years, and then they're grandfathered into a participation score. So we're working very hard to make sure that our kids are getting the best opportunities to pass this graduation requirement course. Of course, there are other options. If a student does not pass the Park Algebra 1 test the first time or a second time, we have a bridge plan outlined for them, and we'll go over that in a little bit.
Okay. That was my next question.
Sure.
Go ahead. No, go ahead. You answered it.
So in addition to the graduation requirements and the testing requirements, we also have this additional college of career readiness requirement. So by the time the student leaves their junior year, we are required by law to give them a college career readiness assessment. The one we currently offer in the mathematics program is tied to Algebra 2, and we give the Park Algebra 2 as the district-provided assessment tool to gauge college and career readiness. There are other tools that are in use as well. SAT, for instance, is also a qualifier. If you get 500 or better on the math portion, then they are deemed college ready. The AccuPlacer placement assessment is also used to deem college readiness, and if they score a 45 or above on the college level mathematics test, then they get the qualifying score. As part of all this requirement, we're also required to reassess students during their senior years, and we're currently using AccuPlacer as our district provided reassessment tool for students. So as the students go through their high school career, as a student gets to the right class, they take Algebra 2, they take the Park Algebra 2, and it's not always a junior. We have freshmen and sophomores also taking Park Algebra 2. If they do not pass the Park Algebra 2, say at the end of their freshman year, we'll give them the AccuPlacer reassessment during their next appropriate math class, which is usually during a sophomore year. So we're trying to get kids as many opportunities as they can, because when they get the senior year and they're not deemed college ready, that we are required to put them through an experience to get them college ready.
Can I ask you one question? And you may have said this. I was asking Ms. Arlene something. If they're dual enrolled and take a math at the college and they pass that, does that count? And you said that. I'm sorry, I just missed that.
I did not say that. But yes. So if they take a credit bearing, if they qualify for a credit bearing course at Chesapeake, they're college ready. Is there an AccuPlacer score that will place
But does that count as a graduation requirement if they pass a math class that's dual enrolled?
The short answer to that is yes. Typically, students who take college classes are beyond Algebra 2, so they'll already have 3 high school classes by the time they get to that point.
Okay.
Most past Algebra, usually they're past pre-calc when they go into a credit-bearing dual enrollment placement.
Gotcha. Okay, I didn't know.
One more question. These, you're talking about requirements. Are you talking about state? Are you talking about Queen Anne's County? Or what?
Yes.
What is the overall?
So everything I've talked about so far is a state requirement.
Okay, thanks.
Minus the 3 graduation credits for our students to graduate. But the state of Maryland requires 3, an algebra and geometry credit, and then another credit. Most of our students who, their third credit is some sort of Algebra 2 class. Either it's a Part 1 class or it's a full Algebra 2 class.
So we're requiring Queen Anne's County is requiring a little bit more than the state, is what you're saying? On the 4th class?
Every student in the state of Maryland is required to take 1 math credit, up 4 credits by the time they leave high school.
Okay.
With the state law saying they have to have 3 passed.
Okay. Passed. Okay.
So For students who are not deemed college-ready, there are a couple options. We have an advanced topics of Algebra II class, which is intermediate algebra from Chesapeake College. It's their highest non-credit bearing course, and any student who receives a C or better in that class automatically gets deemed college-ready, regardless of the placement score. We also have it placed, every class past Algebra II has a transition course module in it, so we're not putting any obstacles up in front of students who want to continue their coursework into trig and pre-calc if they are ready to do so. Some folks go to, it's about 70% of our kids continue through the pathway. They go to a trig or a pre-calc or a probability and statistics class, and the other 30% or so go towards advanced topics of Algebra II. And we're outfitting each of those students with a module to help them be college ready.
You have an alternative if they're just a bad test taker.
Sure. That would be the advanced topics of Algebra II pathway. So their standing classroom score, as graded by the Chesapeake College grading policy, gives them a college accreditation credit. It also allows them to walk into Chesapeake College into a credit-bearing class. We have an agreement with Chesapeake College that states that if they take advanced topics of Algebra II, they get a C or better, then they're eligible for certain courses without taking another placement test. Oh. AccuPlacer is used around the state, the four-year institutions as well. Not all of them use it. If they take the AccuPlacer either on our system or Chesapeake system, then the four-year schools have access to that data as well. In addition to it, any student that takes it with us, we give them a copy of their score report, so they have it for their records. That's probably enough requirements, right?
Just a couple.
Let's jump into some high school initiatives and some data. So we're currently working, if you guys know me, we're always changing things and always trying to make things better. In our Algebra and Algebra 2 track, we're currently reevaluating that curriculum, and this year we piloted a common assessment program in Algebra 2. The Park Algebra 2 test is a challenging test, so we're trying to make sure that all of our teachers are teaching at the level of rigor that's appropriate to that test and give our kids the best opportunity to get the skills necessary to go to college ready for a credit-bearing course. We feel like our tests are helping to get them there. So we pulled together committees over last summer and a couple times through the course of the year, and we've made some common assessments. So essentially, each Algebra 2 and Honors Algebra 2 math teacher in the district gives a core bank of items each time, and then we use that data to kind of evaluate our curriculum and how kids are performing in comparison and maybe preparation for PARC. This year was our first year in a new pre-calculus and Honors pre-calculus curriculum. We followed the fourth course recommendations from the core standard, common core standard documents, and we procured a new resource, new textbook this year. We're using an online component, so we're monitoring that progress very closely. Again, there's a committee of teachers working on that work. This year, we're in our second year of using Agile Mind and Algebra 1, Geometry, and all of the Algebra 2 core classes. That curriculum has really helped us maintain a good balance between authentic procedural and application knowledge, which is what's recommended by the National Council of Teachers of Mathematics. We also are in our second year of using the Intensified Algebra, Double Block Algebra 1 program, where we've identified students who may be challenged as a first-year Algebra 1 student and give them double the amount of time around a research-based program to help them be successful and gain some prerequisite skills leading into geometry and Algebra 2.
But as I understand, then, everyone gets that if they didn't have Algebra 1 in eighth grade.
So all students in Algebra 1 use the Agile Mind program. The identified students for intensified algebra in high school, all students take 45 minutes year long of Algebra 1. For a student who may need extra support, we give them a double block, so they get two 45-minute blocks to help them. It really adds more time to remediate skills. So the main focal points of the intensified algebra program is before we teach any of the Algebra 1 stuff, we make sure we teach the prerequisites leading into the Algebra 1 skill. We're giving them extra doses of ratios and proportional reasoning and pre-algebra and a little bit of probability and statistics before we teach them the actual concept in Algebra 1. There's about 60 kids in each building in intensified algebra.
Oh, really? Okay. So that's not the fact that, I mean, like, when they're doing scheduling now for high school, I'm involved with that. So if a child was not in Algebra 1 in eighth grade, I thought they get two semesters in a row of Algebra 1. But it's not necessarily that intense one.
Right.
They get two
45-minute blocks of time for the entire year, two semesters, right. 45 minutes. The students who need the extra support get 90-minute double block year long.
Oh, okay.
So you get twice the amount of time.
Okay, right.
let's talk about bridge projects. So the bridge project was just revised by MSD, and the process is very much the same. Essentially, after a student fails the Park Algebra 1 assessment twice, they are eligible to enroll in a bridge project. The bridge project is comprised of four modules and takes a good bit of time under the supervision of a monitor to complete. I'm happy to report that we are the only district in the state of Maryland that's piloting a new program with the Maryland State Department of Education. Mrs. Marla Coppedge over at Queen Anne's is working with MSDE to really look at how the bridge project is being used with kids and any real feedback or recommendations that could be given to MSDE to improve this process along the way. Our current plan is to take the bridge project and embed it in a new course called Transition Algebra. That class would come after the geometry course. It would count as their third credit, and the meat of that curriculum would be the bridge project itself. So it would put the students who need the support in front of a teacher who's trained in the bridge project and allow the students to complete this project as part of their remediation leading up to Algebra 2. So the point of the class is to do two things: to help them get their graduation requirement through a bridge project and provide them extra support to be successful in Algebra 2, which is our college of career readiness class. So we think that this course is being piloted with a small group of kids this year. The pilot will continue next year with one group at each of the buildings. And if all goes well, then we'll make it part of our normal process and routine during the 18-19 school year.
But after geometry? So it'd be algebra, one and two,
no.
Geometry, and then the bridge?
No, our normal sequence is algebra one, geometry, algebra two. So we're going to stick to transition algebra course between geometry and algebra 2. And there's a couple reasons for that. One, we want to provide that support to the students going into algebra 2. We think that the end of this course is going to be the very beginning of algebra 2, so kids feel confident while they walk into this class that sometimes they find scary. The other reason is that we need a second failing score in order to put them in a bridge program. So in order for them to use the bridge project as a graduation requirement, we need them to take the Park Algebra 1 assessment a second time. And that's going to happen at the end of the geometry class. So all students will take Park Algebra 1 at the end of this year's Algebra 1 class. If they did not pass it, we're going to outfit our geometry classes with some remediation, and we'll provide a reassessment opportunity for all students who didn't pass then at the end of geometry. Then if there's a second failing, then we'll immediately put them in a transition algebra class to provide them supports for the bridge project. They'll probably get a third opportunity to reassess as well, because we want them to pass it that way. But in the meantime, the bridge project is intended to cover the content of Park Algebra 1 and provides them the best remediation opportunity to do so.
That don't make sense to me, except for the break. She's sending geometry in the middle of that. So they go to Algebra 1, then they get out of it, they lose it, or they retain it. They go into geometry, and then, very delayed down the road, they go into the second part of algebra. That seems kind of counterproductive.
Well, so when you look at the COMAR regulations on what credits they have to have in math, they must have an Algebra 1 credit, and they must have a geometry credit. So what we're basically doing is putting the two required credits first to make sure to get through that. And then, because the bridge project doesn't have to be completed during a class, so if they get through that in a third credit and they still need a bridge project, we can use a monitor process, kind of like the way we do it right now, after school and during Saturdays, all kinds of ways to give them that opportunity that way. We got to make sure to get through their two courses that are required, like Omar first, before I can put them in a third credit bearing course.
Gotcha. I'm just trying to think about the way it was for us.
That is correct.
And they can work on a bridge project after the first time that they fail?
Yes, we're not necessarily going to do that, because it would still be first semester sophomores. We're going to let them get through the geometry module. One of the initiatives we'll talk about is what we're doing with geometry to help fix that, to help provide that. We're currently brainstorming every possibility we can. We want kids to have lots of opportunities to get through the graduation requirement without sacrificing their achievement and their success along the math pathway. We need students, if they want to go to college, they need to get through Algebra 2 as a minimum. If they want, typically, we want them to do trig and pre-calc or a probability and statistics course as well. So we're trying to give the kids every opportunity to do so. And I agree with you. If the test is not the way to get the kids through it, the bridge project is, that doesn't mean they can't be successful in Algebra 2 and trig and pre-calc. Mm-hmm. It just means they weren't successful in this test. Mm-hmm. So we're going to give them opportunities earlier in their careers to get through these hurdles so that they can continue on.
So are you saying you don't go right into the bridge project after your first failure on algebra?
There was a change in that regularly. You used to have to take it twice before you could get into a bridge project. And what they found is that what we consider kind of banking those projects, but then they changed the regulation that once you took it once, you didn't have to wait till the second time that you failed. You could start working on those projects. But I think it's a little bit different as it relates to this transition course.
So as part of transition now, districts typically didn't give bridge projects till students were seniors. In this plan, it's getting them into a situation sophomore or junior year. Okay. The other thing, the reason why it's really sitting on inside, the park reassessment in geometry is important, because once we get that score back, we can score it. So that means the transition algebra class, where they're taking a bridge project, is happening right after geometry. We'll have the second score back, so we can score it while they're sitting in the class. So if they're not successful in the project, we can send it back to the class structure with the teacher and provide extra supports to help them get through the project and pass it successfully. It's a process that has lots of steps, but I believe that this gives their kids the best opportunities to get through the Algebra 1 requirement with extra skills needed to continue their pathways to the next classes. If we wait to the senior year, we're really putting all of our Algebra 1 remediation at the end. So this
much sooner.
This is an opportunity to give kids chances to do just what they need to do.
And this is all of our students, not just our college path born.
Yes, all of our students will go through this process.
Mr. Watkins. Being that and that's the Agile Mind program that they use through that as well?
Not.
Or is it an online, you know how Agile Mind is like a program that they use on their Chromebooks and things? I mean, do they have access in the summertime while they're off to maybe access that to get practice for the upcoming year?
So there's a couple places we send kids to for summer support. Agile Mind is available through mid-July, and then it shuts down across the country for the update rollover for about a month. So you have a little bit of access to it. I would say for a parent who wants some additional support, I would say Khan Academy is a great free resource out there. And the way it's set up right now, a parent could set up an account for themselves as a parent, assign stuff to students, and it gives them feedback, and you can monitor progress.
Yeah,
and
that's
it's all
a good
free.
Idea.
Mm-hmm. The very first module in Khan Academy shows you how to do it. I just recently did it because a parent called and I wanted to help them through it. It only took 10 minutes to have it up and running.
Okay.
And it's completely free.
Okay.
Decent.
That's good.
That's not just for high school, that's for elementary, middle, and high school.
I've used it to help my child.
It's a good resource. And it's not just for math either, it's for all contexts
right.
as well.
Yeah.
So, good free resource. All right, so as a matter of fact, MSDE is visiting our school today to kind of look at the program and how the bridge project is being used. So accolades go out to Ms. Muller-Kopich at the school because she's working very hard to maintain this new pilot course and to maintain a good communication line with MSDE. So she's working very hard. One of the other initiatives we're working very hard on is a probability and statistics initiative. We want our kids to get through calculus. But all kids in their career pathways don't necessarily need calculus. So in the last year, we've kind of bumped up recruitment and the program around our probability and statistics classes. And so this year, it looks like we're going to have a good bit of increased enrollment in probability and stat and AP statistics at both of our high schools. And really what we're trying to do is give kids another pathway, down a pathway that gets them college ready. If they want to go be a historian, calculus may not be the right class for them. AP statistics may be the right class for them to get some college credit out of. So we're really looking at that this summer and trying to figure out what our next steps are. Could be a new course, could be some other opportunities to help kids be successful in their chosen career pathways. A little bit of data. So each of our courses, grade, really kindergarten through Algebra 2 has a CCCA assessment. That's a cumulative content critical assessment. It's really the most critical content of each of the courses. Most courses have one. In this case, Algebra 1 has one, and it targets about half of the course. It's kind of like a midterm. That's our best picture of our data this year. Every student in 8th grade Algebra 1 and 9th grade Algebra 1 takes this test. This data shows that we are being very successful in our 8th grade Algebra 1 class, and that our 9th grade kids are still working on attaining firm mastery of the content. This is something, this is not content that when we give this test, it's the end of the content. It's showing something that we continue to teach and through the course of the Algebra 1 class. So it's just a snapshot of how kids are performing so far this year. But it's something, it's still reassuring to see that the means are in the 80% to 64% range, because we think that there's a direct correlation between, you know, the yellow and the green and the performance on park. So as we go through the rest of the course, we certainly are using this data to inform our instruction and support to students.
Well, the one reason I think the eighth grade Algebra 1, that's basically honors kids, not
it is
higher level kids that would be, that's why ninth grade is, you know, the rest of them type thing, right?
That is correct. The eighth grade class, eighth grade algebra one class is the last year of the acceleration, the middle school acceleration program.
School honors, okay. Because I don't think that's unusual, though, that in ninth grade, I mean.
It is not. The day is a little better than it was last year going into this test. What we really want to see is performance on par and final exams to really help us justify what we've done with our program. We're keeping, right now our plan is to keep the Algebra 1 course on a year-long 45-minute track in ninth grade so that students have algebra every single day for their ninth grade year, as opposed to the semester block schedule like we do for most of our other classes.
I think the critical piece of this was just like what Bridget shared, this is diagnostic in nature for us. It's not the, as Rob said, we're not park.
It's not what? I'm sorry?
It's not final. It's not park.
Just a snapshot.
This is a snapshot.
Just a normal mastery.
Okay. Let's move to middle school. So here we're also trying a common assessment pilot in grade six. We've used our platform from Agile Mind called Agile Assessment to kind of combine and make some common assessment items and pieces of assessments in that platform for our sixth grade and advanced sixth grade courses. That's going well. It gives us a chance for all sixth grade teachers to kind of see how they're performing against, you know, their district and how their kids are doing. It also gives us a picture of how our curriculum is performing during the course of the year. It's those tests were really created by teachers and revised by teachers. The specialists kind of monitor the progress and then to take them back to their sixth grade teams and talk about how to use that data to inform instruction. Similar to Algebra 2, just in sixth grade. Each year we hope to add some more common assessments to either the courses that we're working on or other courses to kind of keep driving that home. If we increase the level of rigor on our assessments and make sure that they're highly aligned to our curriculum, then we get better feedback on how our curriculum is performing. We are also in our second year of Math 180, which is our targeted intervention for middle school. Essentially, this program targets the really most critical skills in the math foundational program. It targets the applications of addition, subtraction, multiplication, divisions, and fractions to make sure that when students are going through the middle school program that their gaps are filled so that they're successful with the foundational stuff. We've seen good success with students closing their gaps in multiplication and division and fractions through the use of this program. It's a program that we roll out with fidelity, and all four middle schools are using it highly effectively. We're in our third year of Agile Mind with middle school, very much the same as we talked about in high school. It's given us a focal point to build our curriculum around. And the math specialists in the middle school and the elementary school have been engaged in professional learning for the entire year, led by the elementary math specialist from the Maryland State Department of Education. She's come and visited us six times since last June to kind of help us make sure we understand how to support good coaching models with our teachers. Our specialists are an asset and a valuable resource to us in helping students who struggle with students in mathematics, but what they also can provide is some really high quality professional development targeted on one-on-one or a team planning kind of session. So that's the kind of strategies they've spent hours and hours this year learning. And I think we're starting to see that stuff in use regularly in schools, which is very nice.
So have you arranged to get the specialist in to work with your specialist?
Linda Sherman Brooke, yep.
Because it's not something they're routinely doing around the state, it's a resource you have if you needed them.
It is. Linda and I started this conversation probably 2 years ago, and we kind of worked together on what this PD looked like. It was something that I was looking for our team. We certainly need all, me included. It was good training for us to understand how to be good coaches to our colleagues. So she volunteered her time to come over and sit with us.
That's the state person
yep.
you're talking
she
about?
She sure did.
Linda,
yep.
Linda what?
Linda Schoenbrook.
Okay.
So she's a wonderful lady and has really given a lot of time this year to help us with our initiatives.
Great.
Valuable resource. Some little bit of middle school data. So at this current place, we have three critical content assessment data snapshots in. Advanced 7 and 8th grade are still in the testing window, so we don't have full pictures of how their students performed. Grade 6 critical content is on ratios, rates and ratios. Advanced 6 is on rates, ratios, and proportional reasoning. And grade 7 is on proportional reasoning. So it's essentially, the advanced 6 is a combination of the 6 and 7 critical contents because they combine their achievement scores. Again, all these scores have shown improvement in comparison to last year. Again, these are just snapshots of how students are performing on these very targeted standards. The RP standards in middle school are critical content knowledge, and on PARC are the standards that the test is built around. They're really the mastery standards that PARC is built around. So we've built our program around those really important standards. Also, when you look into the research about how kids are ready for Algebra 1, this is a huge prerequisite for pre-algebra and Algebra 1, making sure that they understand proportionality. Elementary. So this year was our first year that we put all of our elementary common assessments on the Unified platform, our Performance Matters platform. In elementary school, for the past four years, we've had a common assessment on every unit for K through 5. This year in K through 4, we put all of those tests into our platform, so all students take them on a bubble sheet, and we capture all their data on either a hand-entered or a bubble sheet. So every teacher has access to their class, and all specialists and school leaders and us as well have access to that data from a global standpoint. So we've really captured that data. Fifth grade is in our fully implemented pilot on using the online platform. So our fifth graders take their unit assessments in the online setting. So they log in and their test is completely online, they answer their questions online, the teacher score it online, and then the data gets dumped into our platform. The data reports we get from the paper and the online are nearly identical. So we get good data back from whether it's paper or online. We're still evaluating how the effectiveness of the online platform. Of course, you guys know PARC is online. So we're trying to get an opportunity for kids to be successful there. Is there how low this goes is still for debate. I'm not sure that a second grader should be taking their tests online, so I'll probably not go on there. But
right.
But there's one big initiative that our district has pulled off this year. And really it's providing schools great data to look at as they're looking at how to improve their instruction and for us to how to improve our curriculum. We're currently targeted using a pilot called Due to Math. It's an targeted intervention for elementary school. We're currently doing it at Kennard Sellersville Elementary School and the fifth grade at Sellersville Middle School. Graceville also has a version of it that they're using as part of this as well. And what this is a partnership with Special Education Department and Mrs. McGowan. We identified some of her grant money to help us outfit our initiatives and ensure kids who are falling behind are getting the right resources and the right remediations to fix that going forward. We're seeing success in this program as well. There's a test. It tells us what kind of mathematics the student is struggling in. Are they struggling in addition with single digits or multiplication with double digits or fraction understanding? And then they get a focused 30 lessons on that targeted area, and they get remediated, and we've seen kids significantly raise their skill levels as a result of it. Hopefully we're going to be able to expand this to more schools later in further years. The elementary specialists, like the middle school specialists, were also engaged in that instructional coaching models. So as a vertical team, we had an opportunity to participate in that. We'll go over that again. Our elementary school progress. So in third, fourth, and fifth grade, we actually have two critical content assessments. We have one on the operations and algebraic reasoning track, and one on the numbers and fractions track. So the OA and MBT tracks are already available, and you can see how the students performed in third, fourth, and fifth grade. This is really a progression of skills. There's a lot of repeated skills. So for instance, in third grade, we start really multiplication, and in fourth grade and fifth grade, we add to and complete multiplication. But in fifth grade, they're supposed to be completely fluent in all fifth grade multiplication skills. They should be able to apply it to fraction world. So you can see how our students are performing there. We do have the fraction data in for fifth grade. You can see how they're performing there. So by fifth grade, they're doing everything, all the operations with fractions with the exception of division. So by the end of fifth grade, they're supposed to be fluent in addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, mm-hmm. in whole numbers and rational numbers, with the exception of divide and fractions. So our next steps are really curriculum writing. We will start up. We had about 60 curriculum writers last year working on math curriculum, and it looks like we'll have in ballpark this year. Each elementary level has a committee of folks that have been working. Many of them, this will be a fourth year working on their curriculum. Each school has an opportunity to put one person from each building onto their grade level committee. So third grade, if your building has a third grade, you have a chance to put one of your team members on this committee so that we have every school represented with a specialist leading the charge. And that's the model we use for K to five. In middle school and high school, it's not quite that clean. We get as many teachers who are available and willing to do this work. Last year we had, I think we had 6 middle school and 10 high school folks working on this work. What our focuses are, basically making sure our assessments are highly aligned to our standards, making sure that the resulting data reports are telling us what we need to know, mm-hmm. and making sure our curriculums are state-of-the-art and aligned to the things that we know get kids to be successful in mathematics. It all boils down to Algebra 2. Our kids at the end of Algebra 2, college ready. So the work we do in third grade and fourth grade and fifth grade matters mm-hmm. heavily when they get to those upper level classes. And the common assessment thing is something that we're always working towards. We also will identify needs for our professional development days and talk about really how to deliver really high-end, high-quality professional development to all levels of our teachers. It's a really important day for us. That concludes my presentation. It looks like I went over a little bit. My apologies for that. I certainly can field any questions you guys have this time.
I have one thing is, it's not, might not be related just to math, might not be related to math at all, but as far as testing, like the PART test, there are tests that my child has had in eighth grade where he'll come home and say, I'm taking this test, and the teacher doesn't really know what's on it, but, you know, and it's one of the standardized tests, and the teacher doesn't know what's on it, they think this is what's on it, so do they have like a general guideline they've been teaching on to meet the standard, because it's not like the teacher sees the test.
So can I speak from my program? Yeah. So that's not the case in the math program.
Okay.
So the curriculum guides are developed with heavy input from the teachers. Each unit, each course has a curriculum guide that includes an overview, a casing guide, and a unit breakdown for what they should be teaching and kind of when they should be teaching it. For the courses that have a common assessment, it's available to the teachers to have access to. I'll be honest with you, like in sixth grade, all of them had a say in the items that were on the tests.
Okay.
Right. As far as the critical contents and that assessment, that also is available through their curriculum guides. So we want teachers to align their instruction to the to the test. If the tests are supposed to be a driving force behind the really increasing rigor and making sure that everything's aligned, you got to be able to see it. The only test in the mathematics program that we don't allow access to is the benchmark. And it's at the very end of the year. It's the one test that while they've seen it, and it's one we've used regularly through the last 5 years, it's really our one, let's see how our kids are doing without high alignment, because we think that all the other tests that we've done align us to that test. And that test doesn't count as a student score. It's a diagnostic test for us. All the other ones are student graded and count towards their grade. So anything, this is my philosophy, anything in the, it should go, that goes into a teacher grade book, teachers have got to have access to.
Right, and I'm not saying they shouldn't. I agree with that. And yet there's a line where you don't teach just to the test. And I understand, and that's great. So then they're getting what they need based on what you think is on the test. The other one, that the feedback loop is the one that the parents have been concerned with. But this is parents about 2 years ago, and I don't know if that's improved, where they don't know what their child did wrong on the test because they can't see the test. So they're interested in knowing so they can make sure their child understands the information, whether they can retake it or not. So I don't know if that still exists, where you can't see some of these tests to learn from them.
There's no guidelines from me, from my department, saying you can't send a test home to the parents. In fact, I think they should get them. The tests are online, and in elementary school, there's a printable responses report that the teachers send home to their parents.
This was a high school concern, so
I'll take it back and make sure.
I don't know if it was math. I'm just saying they exist.
We'll double check anyway.
Okay, thanks.
Well, I think this is a great conversation around alignment. We keep talking about that, and is how, you know, our philosophically we believe that there should be no surprise by the time that they go in to take an assessment. And if the teacher, as Rob was kind of pointing out, if the curriculum is aligned appropriately and the teacher's following that with some kind of fidelity, then we should see intended results, which is what we're seeing in mathematics. If you remember in the audit, the mathematics curriculum scored the highest. And a side note to that, under Ms. Paul's leadership, is very strategic that Mr. Watkins is leading Team 3, which is the curriculum, the assessment, and the alignment. And they're doing some work now on kind of philosophically, what do we believe that a curriculum should look like for teachers? So I want to applaud Mr. Watkins, not only his mathematics, but his leadership in curriculum design and development that's helping all the other content areas be able to take a look at that. So I appreciate his leadership and Ms. Paul's leadership as well.
I think a huge part of that was from the audit. Rob actually had the highest ratings with his curriculum, so it would behoove us not to have him to lead the charge. Also, he has more assessments in place, and so he's really able to monitor that alignment and make sure that it's good. But if you would try to find out what content that was,
yeah,
we can certainly.
And it was a couple of years ago, may have already been corrected.
Okay.
Check.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Watkins, we thank you for your leadership.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good day, everybody.
You too.
High school schedule.
I think we have a.
You said after presentation.
After that one.
Okay.
Okay. We forgot to do that.
Alrighty. I need a motion to approve the agenda for today.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
I have a motion, second. Any questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
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 All opposed say no. The ayes have it. Mr. Lucy, next we're going to do
Did you want to move into a break?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't say it.
And then we'll come back. Would you like to say 30 minutes at 12:45 or less? I mean, I think we had scheduled for 30 minutes.
Yeah,
so we'll come back at 12:45 and we'll start the presentation on high schools.
Yep,
on
fine.
Scheduling.
Mm-hmm.
If that's okay.
Yeah,
okay.
That sounds good. We need a motion to clear.
Nope, we don't need a motion to take a break.
All righty. Be back at
12:45. Okay.
Thanks. And we're going to have a presentation by.
Yes, we have with us today at the board's request requested that we do an overview of our high school schedules for each of our schools. So we are honored today, not only one to have Mr. Brad Engel, our supervisor of all things in student support services, that's going to kick some of this off, as well as joining from principal from Kent Island High School, Mr. John Treckengoss, and his school department chair, Mrs. Kelly Ruby. Amy Hudock could not join us today. She had actually gone home sick today. So Mr. Willis is going to, he was also part of the presentation, but he'll be able to bring the perspective from Queen Anne's County High School. So we've kind of combined both high schools into one presentation. So, Mr. Engel, I'm going to turn it over to you. And
yeah, thank you for introducing everybody. Good afternoon. I'm going to just be manning the presentation. This is really their presentation because they're the experts in scheduling. So this time, I guess we'll just sort of kick it off. Obviously, the schools have their processes and procedures, and so I guess they can kind of take turns explaining when they're finished. So I guess we'll go on to the first slide. The purpose is to provide an overview of the scheduling practices at each high school. And I don't know if anybody wanted to add to our graduation requirements. We talked a little bit about that.
Jump in.
I could go through it quickly.
Just quickly, please.
Fine,
John.
Yes. Yeah. So as you know, in our school system, our students need 26 high school credits in order to graduate. They accumulate those really from 8th grade on through 12th grade. Really, by law, they must be enrolled at least 8 semesters beyond 8th grade unless there are special considerations or circumstances. And at that point, we request a waiver by our superintendent to graduate earlier than those 8 semesters. Obviously, part of the graduation requirements are to meet all the state testing requirements, as well as complete their service learning hours.
Okay. How many are their service learning hours? Are they required?
75.
75, that's what I thought it was.
It's
okay.
Probably good to add to that we require projects. I mean, all the other counties around us have the 75 hour, but we have the five, as it says up there, the five required projects that are embedded grade 7 through 12. So middle school, each year they're getting 3 of them. and then the other two are picked up in the high school.
Okay.
Those are embedded within the curriculum.
Right.
So
right.
As they're learning that curriculum, they're exposed to that, and then they get credit for
That's
it.
A question that we get all the time.
Yeah.
That was How many that. Hours do I need?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
You really don't need hours. It's the projects.
Okay.
Each project equates to about 15 hours.
Okay.
Especially kids transferring in.
Yep.
That is an important point. A student, a family should expect if their student attends and participates that we will guide them through those hours.
Okay. Yep.
And the projects.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
Yes. It's part of what they do
right.
with us. These haven't changed for a while. You can read through the specific courses that you need within those 26. I guess a special note is within math. There are 3 credits of math in order to graduate, though the students must be enrolled in math each year. So our seniors now, even though they may have the 3 credits, will be enrolled in a math class. Really, starting with, it's been our goal for quite some time, but starting next year, it'll be a requirement.
I always thought it was.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was 4 years English and 4 years math.
You're just coming on the heels. Mr. Watkins just did a presentation on that. So this actually came up as
yeah.
part of that. So he did a great explanation as well.
The students may think it's a requirement because we all push it.
Right.
So they don't know any better. Which
right.
It works out.
Questions?
So many different.
That's right.
And then there's a list of pathways.
And each student must have a graduate with a pathway in order to graduate.
When is that developed?
Many of them start that in 9th grade. Some will wait until 10th grade. There are a lot of the CTE programs mm-hmm. that are housed at Queen Anne's, you can't start until a 10th or mm-hmm. 11th grade. So
okay.
It kind of varies depending on the program.
Great. Can they switch their pathways if they're not happy with the way that it's going or change their interests?
You can absolutely change it as long as it's not too late. For example, many times seniors can't change or second semester juniors can't change because they don't have enough time to finish all 4 classes in the pathway
okay.
if they haven't started an additional one yet. But yes, they can certainly change up until the point where it's unchangeable to try to get everything in that needs to be.
And usually to add with that, as you look at the pathways, you also see, if you go back, a lot of people would say, well, I'm in the college prep tract, to use the old term. Really, they're all the pathways, and you're looking at being a University of Maryland completer and also a CTE completer, and we're trying to, I guess you would say, guide, coerce, however you wanted to, have them be dual completers in both in each area. It doesn't happen all the time, but that's usually we start out with that intent.
Okay.
Within both of our high schools that require, as we work toward a 4-year plan, as students kind of prepare that as they both come in to 9th grade based upon interest, a variety of things.
So if they don't know right off the bat going into 10th or 9th grade what they want to do, if they're clueless, most of my friends go toward that liberal studies thing.
Well, and a lot of times too, we will talk to them about what their goals are and what some of their interests are, and it's at that point it's a great time to take classes in different areas to see if one of those areas spark an interest to complete a pathway then in something that interests them. So a lot of times we'll have students in 2 or 3 of the beginning classes to see if that's something that they want to continue in.
And then they use those as like electives? Final, okay.
Right. So we'll walk you through the scheduling process, which is quite complicated, and there are a lot of different arms or offshoots to some of these bullets, but we'll do our best to kind of walk you through that entire process and all those steps, which is quite extensive and covers a large amount of time. Our school counselors are obviously vital in that process, and we start with small group presentations in...
We go into, for the 9th grade, since they're not in our building, we go into their classrooms at the annex, and we do individual presentations about the scheduling process and courses and the program of study and graduation requirements and what colleges are looking for in the 9th grade. In 10th through, in scheduling for rising 11th and 12th, so our current 10th and 11th grade, we do small groups of about 30 to 40
in the auditorium and do the same presentation, but each group is specific to that grade level. So we won't talk about work-based learning with a ninth grader, only those that are going to be seniors. So it is very specific to the grade that they're getting ready to schedule for.
And after that step, you want to talk about really the next two, the students completing their schedule and their parent nights?
So what we do is we complete all of our scheduling presentations with the students. We then have a rising ninth grade parent night for just current eighth graders, and we have a scheduling night that is for rising 10th, 11th, and 12th graders. And during that parent night, we split up as well. So one counselor will take the rising 10th grade, one will take the rising 11, and one will take the rising 12, so that we can also give very specific questions and presentations to those groups of parents. Then there's about a week, usually, after the time that the parent presentations are over, that the students and parents have time to work together to do their presentations, or to pick their schedule at home. So they work together to do that at home. And then for those that don't complete it, we have them come to our scheduling, to our computer lab to do their scheduling with us for those that don't have computer access at home or haven't chosen them at home with their parents. So we do that over those 2 to 3 weeks and give a lot of notification that, you know, this is the deadline, make sure you have your schedule in by this time. If you need help, come see us. And so we give guidance through that. So that covered our parent nights also. After that, we go for 2 days, almost 2 full days, back to the annex and meet individually with every student to go over their requests, talk to them about what their goals are after they graduate, make sure that they are scheduled for what it for the right path that they want to go on. Talk to them about possible pathways, if it's something that they're interested in. Then we
the start of their four-year plan, like you
right. And then we do the same thing for our current 10th and 11th graders in our building. We spend a good 3 weeks meeting with every single student down in our office and going over everything. Have you taken SATs? What's your plan for this? What do you, you know, what college are you thinking about applying to, so we can make sure that we have the correct level of difficulty in your schedule for what you need. Dual enrollment, here's dual enrollment information, work-based learning. So we go over all of the very specific things with the students during those individual meetings at that time.
The next steps are really where I jump in and our administrative team jumps in working with guidance. So now the students have requested their courses. So electronically, they have put in their eight courses, their alternates. So we work now with that information to develop our master schedule, which sometimes is fun, sometimes is tricky. Most of the time, a little bit of both. So what we do at this point, we provide each of our department chairs. Now the department chairs have a large role as well. So we provide those numbers to each of our department chairs. For instance, our math department chair will know how many students have signed up for AP Calculus. We take that number, we divide it by what we consider to be kind of the upper end of a class size, so we select 25. So we divide that number by 25. That will tell us how many sections of AP Calculus we have to have in our master schedule to accommodate all the student requests. Department chairs have all of their numbers. So our math department chair will have each course taught within our math department, the number of students that have signed up for that class, and then our breakdown. So that number divided by 25. They take that information then back to their departments. They then have a week or two to work with those numbers. They then attend a meeting with the content supervisor, Kelly and I, and our academic team. During that meeting, they share really their proposal, what they would like to do as a department to fulfill the student need. At that point, we actually, in the conference room outside of my office, we take our master schedule off, all the pieces come down, and through that meeting, we then put up next year's schedule. So at that point, we know the number of sections for each course, and at that time, really, who is teaching which section and during which semester. So that's the information that we have so far. We like that. We've tweaked this process through the last 6 years now. But we've come up with a formula that seems to work. We appreciate the department chairs working with those numbers. We appreciate the departments really providing us with what they think would work best for them. Really, even prior to that, each of our teachers receives a scheduling request sheet, is what we call it. And on that piece of paper, they share with us the courses that they have taught in the past, the courses that they would like to teach, really the co-teachers that they've had a great experience with, and then any wishes for the schedule. And we use those sheets when we meet. The department chairs use those sheets so that hopefully their course assignments match really their passion, what they would prefer to do, because I believe that's when really you'll get the most out of the entire schedule.
And the last two things we added didn't come out this morning. So our annex schedule, because we have to build a schedule in two different buildings, we have an additional challenge. And we have 12 classrooms available to us in the top floor of the annex, which is where our ninth grade is. So we actually have to sit down and go by hand to say how many classes are first period at the annex, how many are second, because you can't go over 12 because that's all we have. So we try to space out as many as we can and figure out which ones have to come over to the main building. Like our foundations of technology can't be taught at the ninth grade right, or at the annex right now, so we bus them all over. We don't have access to the gym at Mattapeak Middle School for the last period, so those students get bussed over. So we figure out at that point too how our annex schedule is going to work, which can be very difficult to try to place together. And then once we do that and run the whole schedule through PowerSchool, one of the things that we put into place in the last couple of years is that we get back together with all the department chairs again, and John and I will go through, I'll have what comes out of PowerSchool and he'll be at the board, and we'll put everything up on the board so that it matches what's in PowerSchool, and the department chairs say, okay, I see a conflict here. AP Calc is opposite AP Physics, and the kids will take both of those, so we can't offer those at the same period. So we got to move this so that it best benefits where the kids can take both. And so our department chairs really spend some time going through that as well, so that we make sure that we have the best optimal schedule that we can.
We really try to pay attention to our AP courses because most are only offered once throughout the year. Our upper level pathway courses, because those are the same, most are only offered once. So it's those singletons, those courses, and we try to avoid all the conflicts that, you know, our guidance department knows they battle each year. So we try to avoid them right from the start.
Any questions for comments? All right, Mr. Willis, Queen's County.
So a lot of what you heard is gonna be very, very similar. For Queen Anne's, the whole thing is you're looking at schedules that are being built based upon student requests. And what they're requesting, so it's going to be a new schedule every year, and that's why you hear the process, but it's real similar. For us, it starts with, if you have the program of study and you turn it on the back, then the back page is the four-year plan that's there. And usually we start with classroom guidance in ninth grade, going into every English class, so our counselors are broken, that you have grade level counselors, so ninth grade, 10th grade, 11th, and 12th grade, each counselor follows their grade. And then so when you have English 1, those are all those students that that counselor has in common. And then they would use that that four-year plan to begin developing a four-year plan to discuss, look at, you know, what are your thoughts? Are you thinking college? Do you think, and we utilize Naviance, which is, start to give an introduction to the whole Naviance program using Do What You Are, which is kind of an interest inventory that goes along with that kids can use. And then, so they're gonna start those four-year plans. Well, those four-year plans are actually starting a degree of the requests that are going to occur later that year. From that, then those individual meetings is where we'll start having some of those individual meetings after you do a class. You break that class out and then meet with them individually for the purpose of developing that four-year plan. Once we hit to scheduling, that we have an academic planning night, which we've had, where normally we'll use AP Potential, where we'll send out letters to parents regarding AP Potential based off the PSATs that we give every year. That letter will go out stating which, as far as based on the testing that you've done, these are some of the AP classes that you might be interested to just kind of give further interest and thought, and then have the academic planning night where we'll talk about scheduling, talk about AP classes and CTE. The other thing that will occur with our schedule is that we are as also a comprehensive high school, meaning we're also a tech center for the students coming from Kent Island High School. So that gives us another wrinkle that we have to use within our schedule that's going to limit some things. But that academic planning night is basically then we're announcing our scheduling week. We'll put it out through newsletters when that scheduling week will be. And then each of those English classes, again, we're bringing them down by class and setting them in front of the computer in the media center and helping those students then go through and make course selections. Counselors are in there. And if there's any technical issues or anything like that, so that we know that we're getting those good requests that are going in. And then after that, the scheduling week occurs, so we're going to catch every class, every English class with every student. After that, any students that were absent, if parents request it, we put it out in newsletters. We say it at our academic planning night, if parents want to come in and they want to do that individually as a family, they're more than welcome to schedule those times and come in and be able to do that, and we'd be happy to accommodate those. The individual meetings, and then again, we're asking for parents, students to be talking about that four-year plan, do their course selection, and then reviewing all the selections for accuracy to make sure that the four-year plan with what has been put in, each of the counselors is going through and checking to make sure that there's agreement. If there isn't, the expectation is to call a student down, hey, have you changed pathways so that we can keep that four-year plan as accurate as they move forward. And then the process after that is, again, like John and Kelly had mentioned, is then we exactly pull the numbers that we have and the requests come out of PowerSchool. Again, we're looking at the total number of requests versus the staff to see if it'll work. And that becomes an administrative team decision. And then beginning to put together the master schedule. Like Kent Island, we also do meet with coordinators, looking at, and basically it's just a large spreadsheet that's on there that you're looking at to make sure that staffing is there where we're over, where we're under, how we can look at class sizes. Like Kent Island, we also use 25 as our number for class sizes and in those average class sizes. After coordinators have looked at it, we also have to consider then Kent Island High School and getting the information from them, because we do have a number of the programs are application-based, nursing, cosmetology, auto mechanics, masonry, carpentry, EMT, fire and rescue are all application-based, so we're getting applications that are coming, and then looking at a selection process, which is usually coming through our CTE supervisor, and then looking at CTE teachers and making a decision as to who's going to, if need be, a lot of times it's not needed, who's going to gain the entry to those positions. No student is ever cut out of a program, but then there's a waiting list that goes after that. That way, the student that is signing up in March for a program, when we come to July and somebody new comes in, well, they'll go on that waiting list, or we'll begin looking at the waiting list and say, here's how things are offered, so that the person in March isn't cut out for somebody that's coming in July. There's an equitable means to move them up that waiting list. But that provides, basically, that takes all of the CTE because of the transportation issues and the logistics of students going back and forth, is it locks that entire department to our first three periods. And so those schedules are pretty well locked in place. And then our APs, we start looking at the AP classes as to when they can be available, and placing those in the schedule. And also, too, sometimes you're looking at alternates, because every student in both schools is going to select 8 classes with 2 alternates. So the alternates can play a role for us in kind of forecasting what students might change to. So if they're scheduled to an AP calculus and there's a conflict with that AP calculus, well, they had AP statistics, can they still get that? So they're not being totally locked out. And then once that, we've gone through that with department coordinators, then we go and it goes into Power Scheduler. Power Scheduler is again looking at how to optimize the requests to meet for what's the best schedule scenario. And then from there, we're going to start locking down those courses where we think they best fit. And then, like John and Kelly had said, we're going to put up the scheduling board and start looking at it for the department coordinators and this, and then also for special education and co-teaching assignments and things like that that need to go in, how those students can best be met as well. So there's a lot of similarities in how the process works, but there's some subtle differences there as well. So,
questions for both groups. Is there a parental sign-off required so the parents know exactly what the student has signed up for?
We haven't. Where we end up having it is on the CTE applications. That's where there is. When we went to online scheduling, going back a number of years, what we used to do this on paper and pencil, we had to
sign off.
Right.
And I'm just saying that because I have a child who would have gone in there and taken anything in the world that did not pertain to anything that was required or that I suggested.
We send out, both schools in June send out, here's what your student is currently scheduled for, and it goes out to the parents. And for us, we mail that out probably 4 or 5 times throughout the summer.
Okay.
Here's what it is now. Here's what.
Okay.
And it goes out. We send ours out right now through email, so it goes to both the students and the parents. So everybody knows, here's what you're currently enrolled in.
Right. Not that he'd get in 4 PE classes, but he would have tried.
Yeah.
So I'm just
that's
saying.
That's the benefit of our individual meetings.
And that's,
he's not happy with my choices, but.
And that's where we're checking to say,
we
okay,
got to sign it.
I mean, a lot of times, and also with that is, with our academic plan tonight, with putting out the principal's communications and all that, we're saying that this is our scheduling week. Your children will be making course selections.
Choices.
After those course selections, they can go home and you can go online with them, and we tell them, please go online, please look at what they've chosen. If there are changes, please make those changes, and then we'll go and adjust if there's adjustments that need to be made.
Very good.
I have a clarification. Kent Island High, as I understood from the night I went to, if the students, the incoming ninth graders, decide they want that pathway to cosmetology or something, they go over to Queen Anne's. They stay the whole day, though. They do all their classes over there.
3 periods, and they come back to us for lunch and 4th period. And leave. They can play sports and all activities after school.
I didn't know they did one, at least one class at Kent Island.
Just
4th
one class.
I was understanding all of them had to be over there. Okay.
Next steps, post-scheduling.
So, very shortly, I think it's May
2nd.
Our high school committee team will meet, both high schools, the supervisors, along with the superintendent and assistant superintendent. We will meet, we will share kind of the status of our master schedule. Usually it's areas that we're very, very, you know, proud of and some challenges in our master schedule. So we work as a larger group. If there needs to be adjustments, we can make them at that time. Usually it's kind of sharing our progress, sharing kind of the challenges that we're facing at the time as a large group. After that, we kind of go live. So then the students are placed in, we assume that to be our schedule. Really, the master schedule, there could be changes within our master schedule all summer due to, you know, any type of teacher change, personnel change. Sometimes we have too many students enroll for a course that, you know, that's full. We decide to open another section, or vice versa. Many kids end up dropping the course, so we end up dropping it from our master schedule. We have to insert another course in its place. So scheduled changes occur sometimes all the way through the summer.
Right up to the day, first day.
I was going to say, what is the deadline? I mean, after school starts, is there any kind of a period where they can back out?
Yes. Okay. We've been very proud. At least I brag about it all the time. On our first day of school, we have very, very few students who aren't in our first period class at 8 o'clock. Great. So they all have their schedules. They are scheduled, and they're in their classrooms. We do not have kids waiting around for a schedule. Mm-hmm. They're in, and we're ready to go.
That's the best thing you ever did.
That's good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's
great. As a parent of a high schooler, I can tell you that was the best thing.
We're very proud of them. And I give our students a lot of credit because they're responsible. They know. They know that our expectation is to be on class and to follow their schedule, and they do an excellent job with that. But then they have a period of time, and it's 5 days for a semester course. It's a year-long course. They have 10 days, really, to make up their mind. They have an opportunity to sample the course, see the course syllabus, meet the teacher, and at that point within those 5 days, they are able to make schedule changes.
Okay.
Beyond that point, schedules are not changed. Okay. So at that point in time, they remain in the classes, you know, in which they're enrolled.
It's not too bad. I mean, that I think sense. When I went to school, it was 2 weeks, 10 days. Mm-hmm.
Sure. We agree. We think it's very adequate, and students doing a nice job.
Well, you've given a whole lot more time involved in the end result than we ever got, as I remember, as high schoolers. I mean, we sometimes did not pick those until the first week of school.
Right.
And so you threw yourself into a class knowing that you might not be taking it because you had two weeks to get out of
it.
So,
and okay. I think the big thing in, I guess, taming the scheduling beast is to, in June, is to send home a copy as close as you can of this is your schedule. It is tentative. As long as kids understand, and I think everybody's over the years I've been doing it, have been great in understanding that it's subject to change, mm-hmm. teachers, people leaving, changes and things happening. But this is pretty much the way it's gonna look. Mm-hmm. And if we hold to that without major changes, they're going to be calling over the summer and making those adjustments so that when day one hits, I think all of us, our goal is when day one hits, you're there.
That's what they wanted
you like
anyway.
It, and this is what you want.
Very good.
Maybe it'd be helpful if you could share with the board about what percentage would you feel your schedules from 100% being ready to roll to, I mean, I remember when we talked, probably in the 80 range by the time school ends that, so what, if you were to estimate what percentage of your schedule is complete by the time that students leave in June?
That really kind of varies year to year, depending on how our master schedule sits.
Maybe a ballpark would help them?
I would probably say maybe 75%, 75% at the end of school. The earlier that we can get the master schedule built, mm-hmm. the better that becomes, because we can work with students while we still have them there to say, hey, AP French and AP Bio are at the same time, which one do you want?
Right.
So that we don't have to do that over the summer and can work with them while they're still in school.
Right.
So the earlier we get it done, the higher our percentage is before the students leave.
Sure.
It has always been nice to be able to say, if administration and everybody's fine and says, go, for us to be able to resolve conflicts, if you can have probably 2 weeks before school ends to be able to move with that, we can resolve a lot of those conflicts before the end. Reality is it's usually 4 days to where you're resolving those conflicts, and we're trying to get as many kids down to say these are the issues here. We can if we can solve most of that, a hectic ending can always usually make for a smooth starting. Mm-hmm. So
I'm sure having pathways helps. if they're on a pathway, it's going to kind of reduce all these outside, I want to take that, I want to take that. Well, that doesn't fit in your pathway. I would think that that makes a big difference from when my children came through the system, which that did not exist.
The challenges of that are in every four-course, six-course sequence, when they start, there's going to be some attrition. And you got to make sure you have enough to keep a cohort running through it so that you can have, and then you saw all the pathways, keeping those cohorts running through all those pathways. That's where the challenge comes.
Well, I just want to mention one thing. On a personal note, I went to the ninth grade parent meeting, incoming ninth graders at Ken Island. Couldn't speak to it, didn't go to yours as a parent, but it was awesome because there's a lot of anxiety on the whole prospect of going to high school, especially if you have a child you don't think is ready. And so my fears were alleviated a lot by the initial discussion, and including my friends. They're like, that's great. The only tweak I would make is, I was happy that it was geared a lot toward college, mainly because I want my son to go to college.
Sure.
And they were very clear about other pathways exist, and those classes are at Queen Anne's. So I think to accommodate the career-ready portion of our responsibility, I would perhaps an idea would be to have Queen Anne, someone show up to talk about, if you think you're interested in this pathway, that's good, that's okay. That may be what you are interested in, maybe what your parents are interested for you having, and then maybe have a side meeting with them right after to say if you're interested in this. But the college side, most of the parents are very happy with the emphasis on college and your emphasis on getting them the classes they need to go to four-year colleges. I think that was very, very well received.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I will tell you that we don't do it in ninth grade because there are so many anxieties of coming into ninth grade, and we kind of want to relieve that and just say, here's what we really should be doing. But in our 10th through 12th grade scheduling night, we have all the teachers from all departments ahead of time so that parents can come ask any questions that they have. And in the past, we've had teachers from Queen Anne's come over, and they've been a part of it as well. So it is open to 10th through 12th grade when you're scheduling for that to come ask any questions you want of all those departments. But
okay,
I
that's
appreciate
good, 'cause I noticed on the schedule too, a lot of those classes starting with the pathways don't really happen until 10th grade.
Yes.
So that makes sense to me then. Okay.
Yes.
Great. Thank you.
And I know just to that, Captain Kelly, I know in the winter, Ms. Pauls and I attended the one of the community Baptist events that Mrs. Hudock had. And one of the things that we heard from parents was very similar. The anxiety over ninth grade, and Ms. Pauls has been spearheading with the school a booklet with to help parents better understand, because they're going to get into the complexities of what does it look like in a schedule. And that does alleviate some stress of it's very complicated, and understanding just how does it.
Books though, the Queen Anne's doesn't have one yet.
They have a program of study, but what the parents requested was something for ninth grade parents. They felt
incoming.
As though they did not know a lot of the do's and don'ts and ins and outs of being a parent
Bees
of a freshman for the first time.
Okay.
First
okay.
time parents. So.
So you mean when Ms. Hudock was in the middle school?
No, when she assumed the responsibility at the high school, when we were listening to parents, one of the things that the parents had mentioned was having current ninth graders, that it would have been helpful coming from the middle school to the high school to have a document that says, well, we didn't realize there's these fees, or we didn't realize that there's, you know, the ID card. And if you just the little nuances of being at a high school, including things such as the school schedule as well. So it was really kind of geared towards incoming ninth grade parents.
So this is a high school bell schedule thing. You wanted to touch on that. And then you have the Queen Anne County High School bell schedule. So I know we ran over our time, but it was a very good explanation.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Lots of good questions. Appreciate you guys for being here.
So different now.
It is, like, no kid left behind, huh? Can't leave them.
So we appreciate both of our.
Everybody, but I mean, I can, it doesn't make any difference. I have a child, which you know. How do we go about contacting schools to go visit this summer?
As far as college visits?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Do we do that, or can we have the school help us do that?
Couple things. Well, two ways. One is, yeah, you can, on their websites, usually under admissions, you're mm-hmm. going to see contact information
okay.
to set up a college visit. But also, during the school year, if there are certain colleges, we'll put it out to students to let us know. We'll
okay.
contact them, because most all these admissions counselors, in the fall, they go on the road, and they're going to be coming to the schools.
Mm-hmm.
And so we'll set up meetings at different times, and then it's listed on Naviance. The kids just have to check and see
okay.
what colleges are coming and what date
oh,
and
okay.
when.
Okay.
And then they can come down and listen to that admissions
okay.
counselor.
But I'll also tell you that one of the things that we recommend all the time to our parents, even starting in ninth grade, is if you're going on vacation, there are plenty of colleges off 95 and 81, and
right.
Just get off and drive through the campus.
Right.
So it, at least
right.
it gives them exposure to be on a college campus, and they can
right.
say, I really like this. Or I always say, like, I like the old ones and with the big white columns and the magnolia trees, and some mm. kids are like, it stinks and it's old here, you know? So there
yeah.
are things I like that they might not like.
Yeah.
So mm. just getting them on a college campus will be something that
right.
is of any benefit. Anytime you can go on and just drive through, huge benefit.
Yeah. Even if it's one you're not thinking of, if you have
ninth
oh,
grade,
that's college.
Let's
right.
go see what it is.
Right,
there can be.
They'll know if they want to come back.
That's right.
Yeah,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's
but
cool.
it gives
yeah.
it gives something to compare to.
Mm-hmm.
But how many colleges attend our college fairs, give or take?
Our first 2 years we had about 90, and then we mm. had a conflict. Mm. our day being, we always schedule it back to back with Chesapeake College Night when they have theirs, and the one at our school then happened to be our half-day PSAT day for the last couple of years, so we've had a struggle with that.
Mm-hmm.
And we've had about 50 or so. Next year, we are back to being back-to-back, so we're hoping to be back around 90 for that. And
wow.
the one at Chesapeake is usually about 190 to 100 colleges at Chesapeake as well.
We've run 30 to about 50 that'll come in and do individual meetings. Depends on you
right.
as to when they're coming.
And I know you're both working on a career fair, I believe.
We don't have a career fair. We started this year doing career cafes, and we do once a month, and we have selected an area, basically. Our first one was law enforcement and criminal justice and law enforcement. We've done a medical, I couldn't come up with it. We've done a medical one. We've done a computer science one, and our one in April is actually basically just for seniors. It is companies who've contacted us saying they want to hire students right out of high school for full-time jobs. So we have that set up for next week, next Wednesday, and
perfect.
I believe we have six companies coming who are, like, TSA is one of them, and NRL, which is in our business park across the street. There's a landscaping company, a yacht management company. So they're coming in to actually do a hiring fair, basically, with our seniors who, you know, are not sure what they really want to do. So we don't really do a fair, but we've done it monthly, and we've had great response from the presenters and the students. We have about 40 students who attend each one when we have it. We do it over the lunch period, and it's been a great response. So look forward to continuing that next year.
Yeah, we haven't had a fair, but I know I have had. For seniors, I've put out, I've been contacted by Brambles, by Dixon Valve and Coupling, by Tree Company, I think it's probably the same one, Hardscapes, I think it's called. also Best Incorporated, that are looking to hire and have been putting that out in newsletters and have had some students that have been coming in and interested. And then, and have said that if we get a nucleus of a number and we want to have them come in, we'll try to do that. But in most of these cases, I've been referring them out to those businesses to who the contact point of contacts are there.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I want to just thank both of our schools for being here and representing and giving you kind of a little bit of a snapshot of kind of the scheduling process that can be very complicated. I appreciate their leadership. And just to give you kind of food for thought is when they were talking about getting their schedules ready and opening schools, they're already thinking about the next year's schedule when we put kids in school. So we talk about being 98%, 100%, that it from them, they're already really beginning to think about when kids are in school, what it takes to put the next schedule together. So that takes a lot of visioning and a lot of long-term planning to be able to pull that off.
And
so
thanks to Ms. Paul, because she developed a lot of the presentation.
We did it together. We work as a team, all of us. Good job, team.
As a team,
great presentation.
We've called them the partners.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good. Thank you.
I've got the. Let me give you his telephone number.
I'm trying.
Because I know he's ready to hire.
Can I have a motion that we adjourn the meeting?
So moved.
I have a motion and it's been second. Any questions or any comments? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it. Meeting adjourned. Where's my gavel?
Good. Thank you, everyone.
Talk to him because he
You're welcome.